You may or may not be very familiar with the work of the Royal School of Church Music. But you're an educational charity whose mission is to develop, support and nurture church musicians and to encourage the church to make the best use of music in worship. The RSCM was founded back in 1927 by Sir Sidney Nicholson, and he could little have imagined the world of 2020, where for a time worship could only happen online and where the practical arrangements required to enable music making of any sort could be quite so challenging. But his passion for harnessing the power of music in worship and for encouraging all those that are responsible for it remains our passion today. We're glad to be able to respond proactively to the challenges the current circumstances present. The climate around us show our work and resources needed more than ever. We've had to adapt, change our offerings and show others how they must do that too, and we're working as best we can to build on our heritage, enabling new kinds of growth and development for the future. There is still much to celebrate, and the RSCM remains a stable presence alongside all those who do so much to sustain music and worship. In particular, we work to equip churches, their local communities, and their clergy, musicians and singers with practical resources and advice. Choral music remains vitally important to us, but we are not just for choirs. We want to help make churches use the best of their resources in a wide range of musical styles. The RSCM is an independent charity. We don't get money from the government or the church, but we work closely alongside the church and continue to do our utmost to help shape its future. We are thankful for all our members and supporters who enable us to keep doing this. You can join them, perhaps by becoming a member yourself, or donating, or by giving your support in a more practical way. Details of all these things are on our website, rscm.org.uk. We know that so many people value our work, but that news of what we can offer to others in support needs to be spread wider. Please help us by sharing in that task. Thank you.
Well, good afternoon and welcome to the third in this series of lunchtime lectures from the Royal School of Church Music. My name is Tim Ruffer. I'm Head of Publishing at the Royal School of Church Music, and it's my great pleasure to welcome Canon Charles Stewart, Vicar of Christchurch Priory, and and a past member of the Monte Verdi Choir and a conductor of many performances of Bach, who will take us on a journey from Advent to Epiphany with Johann Sebastian Bach, looking at his choral and organ music. Good afternoon, Charles, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Very good to be with you all.
The lecture will last approximately 40 minutes. Do use the chat feed to tell us where you are joining from and to ask any questions. I'll keep an eye on these and put some of them to Charles in the Q&A session at the end. At the end of the lecture, I will also be giving out this week's code for any non-RSCM members who want to take advantage of our offer to become an individual member of the RSCM for a year at a special 10% discount. This code will only last until 5 p.m. next Thursday. And now over to you, Charles.
Thank you. Most of us know, probably from experience, what it is to benefit from having a good guide with us. That may have been on a country walk we've done before, but doing it with a guide draws our attention to this or that plant, or to a particular bird song that otherwise we'd probably have missed. Or perhaps to go to a famous church and to appreciate it to a degree with our own knowledge or sensibility of such things, only to discover so much more through the eyes and experience of a hopefully not too intrusive guide. I guess we've met most of the intrusive ones. The classic example for me was actually on a tour with the Monteverdi Choir back in 85. We were in Venice and we'd sung the Vespers in San Marco, and we're going to be singing it again on the following night. On the day in between, I, with a couple of colleagues from the choir, joined up on a little tour that we'd come across, led by an English retired art historian. And it was remarkable the way that the building I thought I knew, I'd been there before, I'd sung in it the previous night, came to life in a new way, and of course it utterly transformed, for me at least, and I think for my colleagues, the performance that next night. And you may have your own examples. It's in that spirit that I want to encourage us all to invite the music, the interpretative theology in the music of J.S. Bach to be our beneficial guide from Advent to Epiphany. And one of the reasons for recommending him as a guide is because I suspect it's not going to be the first time for any of us on this meeting that we have traversed these weeks. We know much of the music. We know the kind of services that happen. This is familiar turf. We know and probably expect what this particular devotional journey in the Christian year can look and sound like. So I hope it may make it all the more intriguing today to open up our ears and hearts and minds and imaginations to insights from Bach's music. Now, it may seem perverse, and I apologize if it does, but I actually want to start, as it were, last Sunday, the Sunday before Advent. That's because in the church's year, nothing comes out of a vacuum. And in Leipzig, Advent, like Lent, was a season, by and large, without concerted music. The fast before the feast. There was a cantata on the first Sunday of Advent, because that counted as a festival. But for the remaining Sundays between then and Christmas Day, the musical fare was intentionally thin. Not that I'm, comparing it to what we're having to go through this year, but I don't know if you're planning carol services where you are. How are you coping with the thought of not having the congregation being able to sing? So, as I say, I want to start the week before, Sunday before Advent, which in 1731, when Bach wrote Cantata 140, Wachet auf, that fell on November the 25th. So it's quite close. It's a famous and well-known cantata. We're going to hear the first of our musical excerpts. I'm going to post an apology at the beginning. We're not going to be able to hear the whole of every piece, at least not unless you want the lecture to go on till about 2:30, and I guess you have other things to go on to. We're going to hear it in a moment. The instrumental opening, which introduces the very well-known tune. Some of us may know it from our own hymn books, Wake, O Wake, Sleepers Wake. And I want to play it for several reasons. The first is because it gives us a sense of what, not only of what they were hearing before, but also beginning to let us know how Bach takes a text and then takes us deeper into what it might mean. The text translates as, wake up, wachet auf, the voice of the watchman calls to us, from the battlements. Now, I don't know how you wake somebody up. I don't have to do it very often now. The children have long left home. Sometimes a wake-up call might be urgent, something imminent, maybe even dangerous. Sometimes it can be gentle. Wake up, darling, it's your mother on the phone, whatever it might be. Bach doesn't do either of these. Rather, this music, and you may know it, is in triple time. It's full of rhythm. You've got lovely dotted strings, yum, ta-da, ta-da, ta-da. There's a certain grandeur. There's a wonderful contrast in the instrumentation. No one's in any kind of hurry. What's happening? Well, if we look further into the text, it's like that because the bridegroom is on his way. The bridegroom is coming. And that's why they sing Hallelujah, because the whole range of the messianic prophecy and expectations translated into this confident and majestic and stately dance. Now, if the technology works, you should be able to see the texts in German along with the track. So, Sam, if you'd like to start the first track, please.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sam. Oh, very expertly faded. Thank you. That's what they heard the week before, as I said. Now, the following week, on Advent Sunday, we're in a very different place. And the cantata I've chosen to make a contrast is one of his most famous Advent cantatas, Cantata 61, Nun komm der Heiden Heiland. And that was the cantata that was performed on Advent Sunday in 1723, Bach's first Advent in Leipzig. Now, we'll hear the beginning in a moment, and it shares some of the characteristics of Wacket Auf. It's another overture-type movement, though the tone is very different. It's in a minor key, and the string writing isn't so much dotted as jagged. When the singers come in, it's very austere vocal writing. There's none of the polyphony straight away. Each of the different voice parts in turn sings in unison the first line of the chorale upon which it's based. And only then do we get some richness in the choral setting. They'd heard the promise of the coming of the bridegroom of the Messiah the previous week. It's hard to escape the feeling with this cantata that maybe that arrival, that coming, isn't quite so attractive a possibility as they might have thought a few days earlier. Cantata 61 suggests that Advent, looking both to the coming of Christ as a baby, but also looking forward to the second coming, is indeed challenging. The words proclaim that the Saviour of the Gentiles is come, but from the sound of it, at least at first, musically, this doesn't seem to be greeted with entirely open arms. Expectation muted perhaps by a sense of dread of judgment. It's only when the third line of the chorale text appears, a translation, because of this all the world wonders, does something brighter and more energetic emerge. Thank you, Sam. Track two. See what I mean? It's only on that third line, at this all the world wonders, that not for the first time, and certainly not the last, the good news comes in the form of a dance. We're suddenly in a very fleet-footed triple meter. We're still by and large in a minor key, but the tone is completely different. Before we move on from Cantata 61, I can't resist playing you a short ariosa for bass, in which Bach uses the familiar words from Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, the words that inspired the Holman Hunt and light of the world. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. Listen to how Bach sets it, because it's fascinating. Thank you, Sam. Track three.
Klopfe an, so jemand meine Stimme hören wird und die Tür auftut, zu dem werde ich eingehen und das Abendmahl mit ihm halte und ihr mit ihm.
Thank you, Sam. I find that quite astonishing. Did you hear how the first knock was there before the singer started singing? And the knocking is gentle. It's gentle. It's just the strings. There's a plucked string sound. And then he joins in with that und klopfe an on the word a knocking. Now, you may say, well, that's just simple word painting. And in a sense it is, but it draws us in closer. And it helps us see that the singer is accommodating that vocal part to the rhythm of Christ's knock at the door. There's a receptiveness beginning to be built in already. It is a gentle knocking. It's not like the sharp rat-a-tat of the KGB at the door, but it's also persistent. And I find spiritual significance in the fact that the sound of the knocking in the strings is indeed gentle. There's no force here. No one's compelled to follow and open the door. The other interesting thing, by the way, about that cantata 61 is that on Bach's working score of that cantata, which, as I said, was used, he'd composed it in Weimar a few years earlier and brought it back for Advent Sunday 1723. In his working copy of that score, he's written down the order of the service for Vespers that day. And that's one of the best ways that scholars since have known what Vespers worship in Leipzig in Bach's day actually looked like. Let's move on. As I said earlier, there was only a cantata on the first Sunday of Advent, nothing of that sort again until Christmas Day. But they did have the organ music. So what I want to do, just to give you a little flavour of that, there's not as much organ music in this lecture as I'd like. That's partly because we haven't got enough time. One of the chorales from the Orgelbüchlein assigned to Advent. It's Gottes Sohn ist kommen, BWV 600. I'm giving you, by the way, all these titles on the shared texts, so that if you want to make a note and follow them through, you can, whether you're a Spotify person or an iTunes person or a YouTube or and whatever. And that's also because, although I know from conversations with Sam that every effort has been made to ensure the best quality of sound that we can over a lecture such as this, it's bound to be compromised a bit. So apologies for that, but do please follow them out. This, as I say, is Gottes Sohn ist kommen, God's Son is come. It's sometimes referred to under Gott durch deine Güte, Lord, through your goodness. There's plenty of other organ music around. There's three other Advent chorales in the Orgelbüchlein. In the so-called Leipzig chorales, sometimes called the 18, there's three much larger settings of Nun komm der Heiden Heiland alone. These were Weimar works in terms of composition that Bach revised when he was at Leipzig. They're on a much bigger scale than the one which we're going to hear, 5 minutes rather than something between one and two. But I want you to try to do something at this point, please. And exercise our imaginations. Nearly three centuries have passed since these chorales would have been heard for the first time by the people of Leipzig. A lot's happened musically since. And I believe it was Helmut Rilling who was the first person to note that we can do many things today. We can have original instruments. We can have authentic versions, Urtext versions. The one thing we can't do is have original listeners, because our musical palettes have gone through everything from the classical period, the romantics. We've gone through all the different strains of the last 100 years or so. So it's quite difficult to put ourselves in the position of imagining we're hearing this music from new. Try it with this little chorale prelude. If you were in Leipzig in the period of Advent, 1723, and heard this, you would only have been hearing Mr. Bach's music for about 6 months. It's all going to be quite new to you. How do you respond to this music? Because this is what you were probably going to hear before the cantata on one of the Sundays, one of the first Sundays of Advent. Thank you, Sam. Track four. Thank you. It's a very short piece. It's actually played there by Stephen Farr. I wonder if we were in the church that day and were listening to that sort of organ with that kind of registration, might we have picked up on the canon between two of the voices? Quite possibly. There's certainly enough there to encourage us, I think, to sing the chorale when the time comes, so maybe it's not such thin fare after all. There's a lot going on in that deceptively little piece. And if the tune sounded slightly familiar, but you couldn't quite place it, it's pretty much the tune that we sing to Lord Thy Word Abideth. I know there are people who like to play one of the Bach cantatas on the relevant Sunday, and obviously he didn't write any for the second, third, and fourth Sunday of Advent. But if you want to, there's nothing to stop you from playing some of the organ music or one of the other Advent Sunday cantatas. The other thing that might be an idea is to try listening to one of the great motets, Com Jesu Com, BWV 229. Not written specifically for Advent, but the text, which will be up in a moment, invites Jesus to come to the believer. And so there's a bit of a correspondence with the themes of the Advent season. In the text, there's the sense that Jesus may respond to the invitation, come, Jesus, come, either by coming to take the dying person to himself. There could be second coming implications. It's likely this motet was composed for a funeral, and the Bach scholars suggest it was written before 1732, because that's the year it was copied by one of Bach's pupils. Now, with regret, we can't hear it all. But the bit we are going to hear, listen out for the way Bach infuses the very first word with meaning and significance. We call it Com Jesu Com. That's its title. And reading the words like that on their own can have meaning. It could be taken any number of ways. But the music, particularly the opening chords, show that there's no positive sense here at all. The single word calm is repeated three times across the two choirs. Calm, 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 and then we're into calm, use a calm. And the pitch of the melody rises, the harmony becomes more intense. And there's a very powerful silence between each of those chords. This cry to Jesus to come is no trivial appeal. It's anguished and it becomes increasingly urgent. And the reason we know that isn't from the words, it's the words interpreted in the music which Bach has written. The next line, Die Kraft verschwindt je mehr und mehr, listen for the falling phrase that comes in both choirs. Die Kraft verschwindt je mehr. Kraft, strength, power, that is disappearing. It's going away more and more. And the way that line works and is passed between the choirs gives a sense of that diminishing vigor. The phrase is shorter. A new sense of breathlessness comes in, continually ebbing for strength before the longing for Christ's peace is articulated. And the bitterness of life is acknowledged. Ich sehne mich. Now, you don't need to know German when you hear the music to know that that's about longing. I long for your peace. So let's hear the first part of Komm, Jesu, komm. Thank you, Sam. Thank you, Sam. Now, I can't encourage you enough to try to look out the rest of that motet and listen out, particularly in the final section. Du bist der rechte Weg, die Wahrheit und das Leben. You are the way, the truth, and the life. See how it just takes wing, and particularly when it gets onto Leben, and these glorious flowing phrases come between the choirs. Anyway, on to Christmas. I'm trying to keep an eye on the watch. The trouble is I do get a bit carried away by this stuff. Apologies. Leipzig, as we've seen already, was quite different from us today. I don't know what happens in any church with which you're linked. Here at Christchurch Priory, before it was cancelled because of lockdown and so on, the first of our Christmas carol events for an external partner would have been on Tuesday evening. And then they would have been most weeknights between then and about the 18th or the 19th of December, except for Fridays, because that's choir practice. And so again, using our imagination, we've not heard any Christmas music this year yet. We've not turned on Classic FM, and heaven knows when they start broadcasting carols. We've not had to do a number of carol services before the day. We're not jaded with Hark the Herald until, you know, before Christmas Day. And we get to Christmas Day and we hear the music that Sam is about to play for track 6. Thank you, Sam. What a wonderful opening. And the drums lead us into it. A real sense of proclamation. Something's happening here. It's what I've sometimes referred to as the classic combination of trumpets, drums, D major, Bach, and God. After all the restraint of Advent, without what John Butt calls, without any sumptuous church music, this is what happened. At least that's what happened on Christmas 1734, and through to Epiphany 1735. Citizens of Leipzig couldn't have had a clue what sort of treat they were in for that year, because something on an altogether greater scale was being given than the, as it were, standard cantatas. I never think it's wise to speak of Bach's cantatas as standard. Again, that's John Butt's phrase. But the number of services that would be happening over the Christmas period to Epiphany meant that a kind of oratorio, we call it the Christmas oratorio, can be put together, consisting in effect of 6 separate cantatas, all linked into a single unity by virtue of sharing the gospel narrative of the nativity from Luke chapter 2 and Matthew chapter 2. Some scholars suggest that Bach may have been adapting a pattern that had taken root recently, that of a multi-part passion cycle performed over several days, but he couldn't have done it at Leipzig because of the local rules and customs. One of the fascinating things about the Christmas oratorio, if you know it, and if you don't, I encourage you to, is that Bach recognizes, and his librettists recognize, because as usual, as in the Passions, the text of the arias and the little arioso movements are by and large scripted by somebody else. But they recognize that none of us can live in a perpetual state of ecstatic jubilation. It's too wearing on ourselves, let alone anyone else. At some point, Christmas oratorio, the euphoria has to give way to something else. And later, we'll see how the Christmas oratorio and its different movements acknowledges this. But the intention is to do something that Janet Baker used to speak about, I don't know if you saw that wonderful BBC TV program. She was referring to the fact that her American agent, when she was doing a recital tour, told her that in the States, a recital had to start with a flash and end with a bang. And what we've just heard in the opening of first part of the Christmas Oratorio is certainly the flash, that wonderful sense of heralding of the good news of the Incarnation with those trumpet fanfares. Brilliant. There was something different on Christmas Day 1723 at Vespers. And that's the piece that we're going to be turning to now, the Magnificat in the version in E flat. Now, I can't see you, so I can't see you waving to me, don't worry. But I guess quite a lot of you may have sung in the Bach Mag, as it tends to be shortened to. And if you have done, it's probably been in the normal D major version, more of those trumpets and drums. But for Christmas 1723, Bach adapted a setting that he'd written probably earlier in the year and brought in four new movements, four Christmas interpolations, and he plugged them in at various points in the Magnificat. The other interesting thing about this is that it's in E-flat major, which can't have been the easiest key to perform. D major is easier. Again, we need to put this in a bit of context. Many of us will be used to the English choral tradition, choral evensong, with a Magnificat every time. In Leipzig, not so. They'd only have a concerted Magnificat setting at Vespers, maybe four times a year. Normally, the main offering musically was the cantata, and Bach had produced one of those a week since he'd arrived at the end of May. But Christmas was one of these occasions. So what we're going to do is to hear two movements. The first is Fecit Potentiam, he scattered, he shone strength with his arm, he scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. And from your knowledge of the way that the Bach Magnificat is normally performed, you would be expecting that to be followed by that fierce tenor aria, Depa sweet, Depa sweet, diminished sevenths all over the place. It's violent, dramatic stuff. Shows Bach knew about three centuries before the liberation theologians the drama and the overturning that there is in the Magnificat. But that Christmas day, they heard something different. So, Sam, if you could please play tracks 7 and 8, and we'll hear what they heard next.
Thank you.
down. That's a very different thing. If we hear it in the D major version, there's a bit of tonal violence when the new key for the tenor aria comes in straight afterwards. Here, it continues in the same key. There's obviously a link intended. And glory to God in the highest, on earth peace, goodwill towards men. It's interesting that Bach, although it's a generally cheerful movement, takes the music into quite minor and dark places on the Et in Terra Pax Hominibus and on Earth Peace. Very different from the way, say, Handel set the same text in the Messiah. And peace on earth. Bum, 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 bum. Very different. This is much more chromatic. It's taking it into quite dark places. It's almost as if Bach is suggesting something of the pain and the complexity of what it was to cost Christ to bring peace on earth through his death and resurrection. Again, the E-flat Christmas version, well worth checking up. Back to the Christmas Oratorio, we're on part three. Incidentally, if you want to listen to the bits on the correct days, not that anybody's going to mind, part one is on Christmas Day, part two on the 26th, St. Stephen's Day, part three on the 27th, St. John's Day, part four on January the 1st, the Feast of the Circumcision, obviously New Year's Day also. In 1735, part five was done on January the 2nd, the very next day. That was the first Sunday after New Year. And then the final one on the 6th, on the Feast of the Epiphany. I want to do a little bit from part three. I've got my eye on the time, Tim. I'm going to keep this as short as I can. Look at the recitative. We're not going to hear it, Sam. We're going to cut straight to the aria in a moment. It describes how the shepherds come running, island, hasting, and they find Mary and Joseph, and they find the babe lying in the manger. And then they spread the word, and there's an urgency about this recitative. What's very interesting, though, is the aria that follows has a very, very different feel. Bear in mind, this is the first time we've had the intimation of what the shepherds found. And the tone of the aria derives from the last words of the recitative, how Mary kept all these words and pondered them in her heart. And that's picked up in the aria, enclose within my heart this glorious wonder. Take it to heart with our faith. If we can just hear the beginning of that, please, Sam. Thank you, Sam. That's fascinating. Bach is obviously finding a way into this outer aria, inviting the believer's heart to keep this miracle, this blessed marvel, steadfastly in our faith. But the sound world for this aria, bear in mind, we've just heard what they found, the infant Jesus in the manger. It's unexpectedly dark. It's in B minor. It's also for an alto with an obbligato and violin. Where might we have heard that before? Well, Bach's listeners would have heard something very like that on Good Friday in 1727. And we'll have heard it any time we've heard the Matthew Passion, that great alto aria, Have Mercy on Me, Lord, Erbarme Dich. It's identical forces, it's the same key, it's the same sense of obbligato violin soaring. So for all the jubilation of the choruses at the heart of part three is a more somber meditation of what it might mean to hold Christ's birth in our hearts and minds and let that shape and strengthen what the text calls our weak faith. And I can't help but wonder also if Bach's music has in mind something that's not mentioned in the text, but from later in the presentation of Christ in the temple, where Mary is told that a sword will pierce your own soul also. I must play you the other organ piece, even though we're running short of time, because I promised that we would. This is, again, from the Orgelbuchlein. The old year is gone. Now, I don't know how you are used to celebrating the new year. I grew up in Edinburgh, where they take these things rather seriously. In fact, one of the difficulties that Scots are having with the COVID-19 issue is that they're being given a free pass for Christmas, but not for Hogmanay. So you might expect us, Alte Jahr vergangenes, yippee. It's not that kind of music. It's not that kind of music at all. The hymn text on which the chorale's base goes back to the late 16th century, second part too early in the 17th, it's a prayer to God who's graciously cared for them through the old year and a prayer to protect them in the year to come, to stand with them. Whatever happens, that it may be a year of blessing. If we can go to track 11, please, Sam. Thank you, Sam. I'm sorry, I've run over time. I hope we can still have time for some questions. I do just want to add one more thing. And we'd have had more time to explore this if we'd had a whole study day. I hope by now you can agree that Bach never does anything by accident when he's composing. And Robin Lever has written, he's a theologian, a Bach scholar. He's also written about what Bach thought he might have been doing in this. He writes this: Bach understood clearly for himself that his music was not intended merely for the entertainment of the congregation, nor simply an adornment to the liturgy. For him, the choral music he wrote for the service of the church was part of its preaching and teaching ministry. His cantatas were written as a kind of oral bridge, linking the biblical readings of the day, the epistle and gospel, with the sermon. Thus Bach, as far as we know, never entered the pulpit or stood at a lectern. Nevertheless, he was just as much a preacher as were the pastors of the churches he served. And for any of us who gain insight through music, who's to say that Robin Lever is wrong? Certainly, he's also proved that Bach's theological library was larger than many Lutheran pastors of the day. I want to finish with a high note, so we'll just begin our final track, which is the very last chorale from part six of the Epiphany music from the Christmas Oratorio. Tim, over to you.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Charles, for a wonderfully absorbing and a timely look at Bach's music. And also a big thank you to my colleague, Sam, who's been working wonderfully at behind the scenes. Thank you, Sam. Now, before we go over to our questions and answers, and now's the time to send in your questions, we are about to go over to Derbyshire from some words from our director, Hugh Morris. Having said that, he seems to have just disappeared. So,
there he comes.
Hello, Hugh.
Hi there. Oh, sorry, Tim. At the very, very moment that you passed it over, something went wrong with the connection here on this computer, so I do apologise. Charles, and from me, thank you for the lecture. It's been really interesting to hear you talking and the great music selection. If only we had longer to listen to all that music. And so just to everybody else, thanks for joining us today. I hope you've really been enjoying the lecture as I have. So last week, there was a pre-recorded video from me because actually I had another meeting at this time saying thank you for the financial support you've given to us. So because we're a charity, we have to do all we can, of course, to steward our resources and, of course, to gain more. So, we've been doing all we can at the moment to support church music and in these extraordinary times, and we're grateful for the support people give us. So this is a kind of wooden collecting plate. If I was standing at the back of the door on the way out of the Christchurch Priory or somewhere else, where, of course, I used to work, although not with Charles, because we didn't cross over. So it would be great to sort of say, please, can you show your appreciation? Now, you can do that. You'll see there's a text code at the bottom of the screen right now. So you can text to 70480 with your phone. You just type the letters RSCM and the number from £5 up to £20, and then it will pass straight across to us. Or we've improved the website. So if you go to rscm.org.uk and click on the donate, it should take you through various donation options so that you can support us that way. We're really grateful to your support, for your support, I should say. Now, I know this is a great chance for people to drop questions in the chat for Tim to be able to put to Charles. So I will duck back out of the conversation. I will resume my seat at my own table where I was enjoying watching the lecture from. So back to you, as it were, both. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Hugh. We also, of course, have our membership offer, and this week's code is 9CJ60GZ9, and that'll expire on Thursday at 5 p.m. So if you want to become a member of the RSCM at a special discount, now's the time to do it. And finally, before we move on to the questions, next week's lecture will be delivered by Nigel Simeon, who will be talking about Leonard Bernstein's Chichester Psalms, which I'm very much looking forward to. So, Charles, let's see if we've got any questions. One from Marion Smales. That's just a thank you. Sorry, Marion. Good to hear from you. There's one from actually from a Mr. Morris in Derbyshire. It's an enormous variety in the music you've shared. Where does the heart of the music lie? What is the key piece you would save from a fire of destruction?
Oh, golly. Desert Island Discs would be hard enough with eight choices. And I think most of us could probably exhaust that with Bach. I think I'd probably go to the Matthew Passion. And that's because one of the most significant events in my life was a performance I conducted of that back in 2011. It was difficult because we'd run out of time in the rehearsal, not because I hadn't planned it, but because the cathedral had suddenly decided without telling us that we had to stop about 20 minutes earlier than we planned. So there was a certain edge. But the beauty of that evening was that the first part went well, but somehow about 10 minutes into part two, something happened. And any of you who've played or sung a lot will probably have that experience where suddenly the sum of all the parts meant a lot more. And I vividly remember the aria Ababadich from that night. Claire Wilkinson was singing. A chap called Ollie was playing the violin, and we were flying at a different level by then, by the grace of God. And I think if I had to, that would probably be the piece.
Now, I know that you've sung extensively with the Monteverdi Choir. John Elliott Gardner has a reputation for, amongst other things, brisk tempi. Do you know of any corroborative evidence that Bach would have been performing his works at the speed that Ellie takes some of his things?
Well, this is one of those areas where angels would fear to tread. my own views on this is you'd have to check what the music sounds like in the buildings for which he was writing. In that the cantatas would have been done on the same Sunday in both churches, one in the morning, one in the afternoon. So in St. Thomas's and in the Nikolai Kirche. I've sung in the former, not in the latter, because until you're playing fast passage work and lots of semiquavers in a particular acoustic, you're not going to know where it really hits. So I'm afraid that's quite a pragmatic answer. Certainly, I do recall, just before I was going to be conducting that performance of the Matthew, Gardner was about to do a tour of performances of the B minor. And I got permission to go in and sit in one of the rehearsals. And I think it was the end of the Gloria in rehearsal. It was at a speed faster than summer lightning. And he turned around to me at the end and he said, Charles, do you think you could sing it at that pace now? And I said, I'm not so sure. For me, that was too fast. And it's one of the dangers, not just for him, but for a number of conductors who are working with fabulously skilled players and singers, that you push to what they can do. And there are some, and I've heard him do it, that occasionally go over the line. But I'll stick with my first answer. See what works in the room.
It's a very, very pertinent thing. I remember having lunch with Sir Philip Ledger. Right. And we were talking about working in the Building of Kings. Mm. And he said that he would dearly love to take many things faster, but the building just wouldn't let him do it. And so, that very much underlines.
I've heard that taken to most ridiculous lengths with a performance of the Verdi Four Sacred Pieces under the dome of St. Paul's Cathedral. And if you know the Te Deum from that, there's this, after a quiet beginning, a plain song, a quiet beginning, suddenly there's a sanctus with two more to follow. And there must have been about a 15-second gap between each of the sanctuses. To let one lot of sound go before the next chord came in. Anyway, on to the next question.
Okay. If Bach produced a new cantata every week, were his singers amazing sight singers?
That's a very good question. He was duty bound to be producing one. He didn't, after the first three, maybe four cycles, he didn't compose one every week. And sometimes he would go back to ones he'd written before, like Cantata 61, which I mentioned that he'd written in Weimar. Again, we're not really going to know, because we don't know what his performances sounded like. My hunch would be that some of them would be pretty ropey, actually. Mm. But the kind of musical education that the boys in the St. Thomas's School received, musically from him, would be of a very high standard. And certainly to find a child, let's keep gender out of it, with a mature enough voice, but above all with enough musical and spiritual understanding to interpret that music, that's pretty rare. So I imagine that the training they had was really of a very high order. The adults and most of the musicians, I think it would be fair to say, were jobbing musicians who would do other things across the town. So they were probably quite quick on the uptake. I mean, you only have to look at those who play for any of the London orchestras or the session recording players, and they'll play anything at sight.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think we might have been unpleasantly surprised by some of the quality of those first hearings.
Okay, finally, Bach choral works can be heard across the world, really, performed by a huge variety of different forces, from one to a part to, you know, 100 singer choral society.
Yeah.
What kind of forces do you think Bach would have had at his disposal for the, you know, Christmas Oratorio at its first performance?
Well, you are now inviting me to go on to the thinnest of Bach's musicological ice. It depends who you read. John Butt, in terms of his recordings, and I'm not on any kind of cut, I think makes the best case for one to a part. The thing that used to worry me doesn't so much now, which was how would the balance be?
Mm.
It seems to work. On the other hand, and it may be because this is the kind of music making that I grew up with, a professional choir of around 20, 28 max, does something rather special. Though with those you'd have more strings and you'd have more everything else. You'll have seen, actually, I don't know if you want to share the last page I have put up. The last bit of the text, you'll see that there are a number of different recordings used there. I've used some Gardner, I've used some Butt, and so on. They come with different emphases. I guess those two conductors and sets of performers are the two I would go to most normally.
Mm-hmm.
I'm also very, very struck by Masaki Suzuki and his Bach Collegium. They're very fine. I find some of his tempi really very good. But I don't know. No one really knows. Some people are rude about each other. I know Gardner was quite rude about what he called the B minor madrigal. And I remember people like Philip Pickett taking exception to that. It's horses for courses. Ideally, I would want it in both. And there is something about hearing a full choral society unleashed in some of that music, which brings something else again. So I would advise having several copies of different styles of all the great pieces if your bank manager isn't going to get too cross with you.
Well, everyone, I think that concludes our time together for today. Thank you very much, Charles, for sharing your passion of Bach and, of course, for giving your time to us today. As I mentioned earlier, next week's lecture focuses on Bernstein's Chichester Psalms. And if you are able to donate or wish to become a member of the RSCM at a discount, The details remain on the screen for a few minutes. Thank you very much indeed for joining us, and I hope you'll be able to be with us again for another RSM Lunchtime Lecture.
Bye-bye.